Hello Vulkan developers! Today we're going to study descriptor indexing, which can help you improve the performance of your Vulkan application and make the use of descriptor sets much more flexible. This feature was introduced as an extension in late 2017 and became part of core Vulkan in 2020. To understand where descriptor indexing may be useful, consider the following simple fragment shader. We have a single texture from which we sample a texel, and this is basically our final color. If we wish to render multiple objects with different textures, or even a single object with multiple textures, we have to bind the corresponding descriptor set to be able to access the correct texture. Now, we could make this an array of textures and access them using a material index, but both the size of the array and the index must be known at compile time. This severely limits the usefulness of the array. Descriptor indexing allows the array to have variable size and the index is no longer a constant. This means that each primitive can have its own index. In addition, the maximum size of the array has been increased to the point where we can actually use any number of textures concurrently. The only limit is the available memory. Therefore, descriptor indexing encourages the use of a single huge array of textures and any other resource. We can actually bind it once and access every texture in every shader invocation. So we can replace the large group of descriptor sets with a single descriptor set to be used for every draw call. This feature is very similar to bindless textures in OpenGL, and it is a milestone on the way to indirect rendering. By the way, I have tutorials on both bindless textures and indirect rendering in OpenGL in case you're interested. Before we get started, I'd like to say a big thank you to Craig, who recently joined the 3D Underground. If you too would like to support this channel, you can do that at patreon.com/ogldev, or by joining the YouTube channel as a member. Descriptor indexing can be quite a challenge to set up, so I've decided to implement it in small steps. Right now, the descriptor layout for our main shader program includes a vertex, index, and uniform buffers, as well as a single texture. Every submesh loaded by SIMP gets its own descriptor set. As a first step, we will use descriptor indexing for the textures only. This means that the texture will move from the current layout to a new layout, which will also include a new SSBO for the metadata that we will need, such as the material index. From this new layout, we will create a single descriptor set with all the textures that we need for this model, as well as the new metadata SSBO. We will bind this descriptor set once before we start rendering the model, and the old descriptor set will be bound as usual before each draw call. Eventually, all resources will move to the new descriptor set, so we will not need to bind anything inside the submesh loop. It is also possible to create a single descriptor set to handle all the models and assets in the game, but right now each model is loaded independently and has all the resources that it needs, so I will leave this to you as an exercise. The first step, as usual, is to enable the feature. This is done by chaining a special structure when we create the logical device. The device info structure already points to a dynamic rendering feature structure using its pnext pointer. All we need to do is to point the dynamic rendering structure to a physical device descriptor indexing feature structure. Don't forget to set its type correctly. Now, descriptor indexing became a core part of Vulkan in version 1.2, so for previous versions you have to request it as an extension. However, I already have a similar piece of code for dynamic rendering, which you can use as a reference, so I'm going to skip any check for descriptor indexing and simply assume that it exists. Next, we have the new descriptor layout. This is where most of the changes are going to be, so I've decided to create yet another version of the graphics pipeline class. This seems to be simpler than trying to maintain backward compatibility on the existing version. So we now have graphics pipeline v3. This class has a new private attribute for the new descriptor set layout of the textures and the metadata SSBO. In addition, the functions that allocate and update the descriptor sets take an additional parameter for the textures descriptor set. Creating the new layout for the textures is very simple. We just need two descriptor set layout binding structures. The textures are going to be hard-coded on binding point 0 and the metadata on binding point 1. Since the shaders will reference two sets, there is no problem using the same binding point on two different sets because each set has its own namespace for this kind of indices. The descriptor type is as usual, combined image sampler for the textures and storage buffer for the metadata. The descriptor count must be large enough to accommodate all your texture needs. For the metadata, one descriptor is enough. The metadata is referenced by the vertex shader and the texture by the fragment shader. We can now create the layout handle as usual. So now we have two descriptor layouts. How do we combine them together to be able to reference them in the same shader program? Using the pipeline layout. Previously, the pipeline layout included a single descriptor layout. Now we make it reference two layouts, the old one for the buffers and the new one for the textures. This allows us to use the set keyword in the shader with different values. Allocation of the descriptor sets is also very simple. We take an additional handle for the textures and call allocateTextureDescriptorSet. This function uses VkAllocateDescriptorSets as usual. We can use the same descriptor pool to allocate descriptors for the two layouts. We need just a single set here and make sure to use the new layout for it. Next we have the function that updates the descriptor sets using the actual resource handles from the model descriptor. The main loop is somewhat shorter because we no longer handle the textures here. Instead, we call a new function called updateTexturesDescriptorSet, which takes the model descriptor and the handle for the texture descriptor set. This function starts by creating an array of descriptor image infos. We set the sampler and the image view using the model descriptor. The image layout is the same as before, shader read-only optimal. We can now create two write descriptor set structures. The first one is for the textures. We use the same binding point, the same number of textures, and pImageInfo points to the array that we've created with the actual handles. The second element is for the metadata. We have a new handle for it in the model descriptor. The offset is 0 and the range is set to cover the entire buffer. This macro is very useful, so you don't need to specify the actual size. The last thing that I want to mention here is the descriptor pool. It is not directly related to descriptor indexing, but since one of the viewers told me that he ran into some problem with it, I decided to fix the implementation. This mainly includes specifying the pool sizes array correctly. The function createDescriptorSet now takes, in addition to the maximum number of sets, the number of textures, uniform buffers, and storage buffers. It creates a vector of descriptor pool size and populates each element with the number of descriptors and the corresponding descriptor type. This vector is pointed to by the pool createInfo structure. As I said, it doesn't matter that we populate descriptor sets of different layouts. We only need to make sure that we have enough descriptors. This function is called when allocating the descriptor sets. The number of textures is set to some high value. we need one uniform buffer for each image and three storage buffers for the vertex, index, and metadata buffers. It's probably better to allocate more resources, but this is working okay for me right now. Next, we have the VkModel class. In this case, I realized that we can maintain backward compatibility without making the code overly complex. So I've added a Boolean flag that indicates that this instance of the class uses descriptor indexing. This flag is passed to the constructor, which saves it. In addition, we also need a new buffer and memory for the metadata, and an additional descriptor set handle for the textures. In terms of the public interface, I duplicated the functions that create descriptor sets and record the command buffer. The new pair simply takes the graphics pipeline v3 instead of v2 as a parameter. The two versions of create descriptor sets are very similar. We just need to call the new versions of allocate descriptor sets and update descriptor sets on the pipeline object, the ones that take the additional set for the textures. Record command buffer has more changes in it. In addition to the loop over the submeshes, which binds the old descriptor set and calls cmd_draw, we also bind the texture descriptor set once before the loop begins. Notice that the first set parameter of the old set is 0, while the new one is 1. You can use any index here, but remember that this can be a point of failure if your shaders are not synchronized with these values. Eventually, we should get rid of the binding inside the loop completely, which hopefully will result in some performance boost. Another very important change here is the first instance parameter in the draw call. Previously, this was 0, which makes sense because we're not using instancing here. In the new version, we are still not using instancing, but we set the first instance to be the submesh index, which is the variable that we loop over. This parameter will be provided to the vertex shader as the base instance and will allow us to index into the metadata array to get the material index of the submesh. Finally, in this class, we have the creation of the metadata buffer. This function is called in the createBuffers function, depending on whether descriptor indexing is enabled. The contents of this buffer is a vector of submesh metadata structures, which contains the material index, the index offset of the current submesh in the index buffer, the number of indices, and the base vertex in the vertex buffer. Right now, we only need the material index, but since we will also need the other parameters in the future, and since SSBOs have strict alignment requirements, I decided to include the other parameters as well, which makes the size of this array 16 bytes. Vulkan likes this type of alignment. So we create a vector of this structure according to the number of submeshes, and we copy the data from the class attribute meshes. As you can see, everything that we need already exists in the source array, so no problem. We can now create an SSBO and initialize it to the contents of the vector. And finally, we can take a look at the shaders. In the vertex shader, we have the same definition of the metadata structure. The names don't have to be the same, but matching the order and the data type is of course critical. We can now define an SSBO to contain an array of this structure. This is basically the same as the SSBOs for the vertex and index buffers, but notice that these guys are on set 0, whereas the metadata is on index 1. Okay, very important to keep this synchronized with the application side. Next, we have an output variable for the material index. This one has to be an integer, unsigned in this case, and since we don't want it to be interpolated, we specify it as flat. We can now use the internal variable gil_base_instance, which contains the submesh index, as I've mentioned, to index into the metadata SSBO and fetch the material index from it to be delivered to the Fragment shader. That's it in terms of the Vertex shader, so let's take a look at the Fragment shader. First of all, notice that we specify that the GLEXT non-uniform qualifier extension is required. This is because of the use of the non-uniform keyword. Next, we have the material index input attribute, which must be flat here as well. Now comes the texture array, which replaces the single texture from the previous tutorial. Descriptor indexing allows us not to specify the size of the array. Also notice that it is located on binding point 0 in set number 1. No problem sharing the same set across multiple shader stages. We have a wrapper function called TextureBindList2D, which samples from the texture array using the material index. Notice the use of the non-uniform ext keyword, which wraps the material index. By default, Vulkan assumes the descriptor indices are uniform, that is, they are the same for all primitives in the draw call. This helps it optimize the code. Since we're using descriptor indexing, we have to use this keyword. We can now use this wrapper function to sample a color using the material index and the texture coordinates that we got from the vertex shader. So if everything is okay, we should be able to render correctly a model with multiple submeshes and multiple textures. Thank you for watching, and I will see you next time.